Hi, everyone. It is now my time to sit down and listen to last month's poll winner, Frank Zappa. That's what took the top place in November. And the winning piece is going to be Peaches in Regalia. Well, what do I know about Frank Zappa and this piece at this point? Not much. Vlad tells me, well, I've heard the name Frank Zappa before, and of course, in the past months, many of you, hundreds and hundreds of times in the comments, have told me you really should try out Frank Zappa and see what his music is like. So, I have that has me thinking I really should check this out. Vlad tells me that his music is absolutely unique, one of a kind, sometimes controversial, unlike other music that I've listened to. So I really don't know what to expect when I put the headphones on. We'll find that out. I'm going to do something today which is a little bit different. I'm going to listen to Frank Zappa's recording of this music, the way he had it recorded. And then Vlad told me that there is an orchestral version of this piece, transcribed for symphonic orchestra by a conductor whose name was Marko Ivanovich. And this performance was done live in 2012 at a Philharmonic festival, television festival in Prague. So I'm also going to, after listening to this recording, I'm going to go straight to the orchestral version and just see how it is because I'm curious and it sounds interesting. So, there we go. Let's dive in and see what happens. This is interesting. First of all, it's flying by really fast. As I'm reading the score here, trying to follow along, I'm mostly just scrolling as fast as my fingers will go and hoping my eyes will focus on the page quickly enough. But it's an interesting collection of sounds and rhythms. The percussion is taking kind of a solo instrumental role in a way. As I'm listening to it, it's featuring almost as if it would be, let's say, violin or something. If I back up a little bit, I'm listening to it. The other instruments are accompanying it. Almost like car horns beeping at each other, right? It's kind of humorous. Let me just keep listening here, okay? So we're at this point where the car horns come in, and it seems to be a shift in the music a little bit. On the score, these car horns are coming in right at what is labeled part two. So, I think that, well, obviously, part two, there's going to be some shift in the music happening. But I didn't even look to see how many parts there are in this song. We passed a sort of intro and then part one. And they came and went so fast. I'll probably go back and listen a little bit. But Now we're at part two. I don't know if there's going to be part three, part four, I don't know. But here, this is what we're hearing as these little beep, 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 beep sounds right here. And when I first opened up the score, I was surprised to see the drum line on the top staff. It really, I'm not used to that. Most of the scores that I've been looking at, but the drum down here at the bottom. And I thought maybe it's just a badly set up score. That happens. But now as I'm listening to the piece, I realize this drum is kind of sitting in top position as a violin or some other orchestral instrument featuring one of the top layers. And so I guess it makes sense to have it sitting at the top there, even though usually drums are sitting on the bottom staff. So there we are. Let's see what happens as we move into this. Interesting. That part two began to feel a bit jazzy. And then it switched to something that sounds a little bit more oriental, just in that last little bit here. Let's back it up again. Slight bit of jazzy feeling. Oriental or Indian sounds like a banjo strumming along. Okay. Sounds a bit like somebody laughing. Piano is very jazz style. Taking little melodic fragments, motifs, and reshaping them. Now it's up here. Fading away. There is a whole lot going on very quickly in this piece of music. It's so much that I can't catch it all on the first listen. But it's interesting. It really is funny. Kind of like somebody telling a kind of dry joke that has a lot of different layers, but you have to pay attention to really get it. This music makes you pay attention. I like the way he reuses and reshapes the material. And at the same time, it feels rather childish. Childlike. I don't mean childish as being in a negative way. I mean childlike. Where he's playing with different sounds. Playing with tonal qualities and different registers. Sometimes it's up here, and then he wants to try out down here, and what if we bounce over here and here and here? It's really dynamic in that way, and it's engaging. I'm going to go now and see what the orchestral version is like, because now I'm really curious. How did the orchestrator, the transcriber, who is also the conductor of this orchestra, adapt it? What did he choose to feature? How did he set it up for standard orchestral instruments? Because personally, I think it works quite well just as it stands. But, you know, we classical musicians, we're not always dry and boring and serious. We do like some fun stuff. This kind of reminds me of some of the music by Copland, or even something like, well, it's the holiday season, right? So I'm immersed in thinking of holiday music and all of that, because that's what happens at this time of year. Something like Sleigh Ride, where But it's more complex than that, of course. But it's that same sort of playful humor, not all strict and formal, but playing around and trying things out and coming up with ways to paint tonal pictures and moods and qualities and characters. So let's go see what this orchestral version is about. Nice little ornament there. Stravinsky. Piano and the flute right together there. Fun. good choice of instrument there. Was really fun. You know, I noticed that even though in the first version the drums featured much more prominently, here they took a bit more of a background role because the instruments chosen have for the other parts have a more powerful melodic presence. And so it gives a different flavor to it, which is nice. I guess I like them both. I do. I want to go back and listen to the original one more time because I heard some things in this orchestral version which I didn't pick up so clearly in the original version. At the same time, I heard some things in the original that didn't really feature over here. I want to listen to the original balance one more time just to see. I want to see if I can hear more this next time around. So, here we go. Da-da-dum, bum, 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 bum. It really stood out in the orchestral version. I didn't pick it up so much here. I mean, it was there, but it didn't seem so outstanding, so prominent, so important to the entire piece. So that's the little figure I'm listening for through this entire piece right now, because I want to see if it really is featured as much as it seemed to be in the orchestral version. That's what I'm listening for. Here it is again. Thank you. He plays with different parts of that figure. He takes one little bit, and he does it over and over. Here it is. Here we hear it again. So that's sandwiches. It's the beginning and the ending of the piece. And in the middle of it, what he's done is taken little elements and messed with them. It's like he's taken some common household item and said, how many different weird things can I do with this item? Or he takes a piece of paper and he says, all right, what sort of unexpected uses, unexpected forms can I put this in? Can we make it look like a monkey? Can we make it look like a potato? Can we make it crawl along like a caterpillar? All these different things. Like, he's playing with it. And that's, I guess, what I am enjoying about this piece the most. It's creatively playful. This makes me want to hear some more Frank Zappa, because you all were right. It's worth paying attention to, and it's fun. I don't mean fun in just along for a fun ride. I mean fun in the way it engages and plays with the subject material and does unexpected things or expected things in an unexpected manner. So I will be coming back to Frank Zappa, I'm sure, and you will get to see me explore more of him in the future at some point. But thank you all. That was my first exposure to his music, and I will come back with an in-depth portion to tell you more once I've had a chance to look at this score, which flies by so fast. There's not really time to unravel it all on the first listen, but I'll come back with that in a few days. I'll see you soon.